Hello, my dear students. This is Hina Kausal and welcome back to the class. In the previous class, we had discussed regarding the chapter Electric Charges and Fields, where we learnt about how to define an electric charge and we also learnt the different important characteristics of electric charges, right? So in today's class, let us try to know more about these electric charges and let us learn regarding conductors and insulators, methods of charging, Coulomb's law in vector form, unit of electric charge, relative permittivity, and also principle of superposition. Let us begin with trying to understand what are conductors and insulators. Let me give you a general example. You might have used a plastic comb, right? So whenever you rub the plastic comb over your dry hair, the plastic comb will get electrified or charged. In the same manner, if you take an metallic spoon, say suppose a steel spoon, and you rub it over dry hair, that metallic spoon will not get electrified, right? What is the reason? Why this happens so, right? It is because different materials will be having different properties, right? And those properties distinguish these materials into conductors and insulators. So now let us try to understand what are these conductors and insulators. So basically every material, whether it is a conductor or insulator, all the materials or matter is basically made up of the fundamental unit called as an atom. And atom, as you know, it consists of a central nucleus which possesses both protons and neutrons, and surrounding to them the electrons will be revolving in different orbits. So this is the basic structure of an atom, right? So these free electrons, which are capable of moving around the nucleus in certain materials, say for example a metallic body, those number of electrons will be more in number, which are capable of moving in the metallic body. Since they are capable of moving in any part of the body, they are also termed as free electrons. If the number of free electrons in any object or any material are more, then obviously they can conduct the electric charge from one part of the body to another part of the body, right? Because of which they can conduct the electricity from one part of the body to the another part of the body, right? So any material which will have many number of free electrons which can carry the electric charge are termed as conductors. So those materials which will be having many number of free electrons which are capable of moving and can carry the electric charge from one part to another part is called as conductor. So examples for these conductors are metals like copper, nickel, iron, so on, right? Human bodies, animal bodies, or earth, all these are examples for conductors. And let's talk about insulators. What are insulators? As I just explained, the free electrons, the outermost orbit electrons, which are capable of moving, those free electrons are less in number in insulators. If there are no free electrons, then what it means? It means the electric charge cannot be carried over from one part of the body to another part of the body, because of which it cannot allow the electricity to pass through them easily, right? Since because of high resistance inside the body, the insulators cannot carry the electricity. Example for these insulators are porcelain, plastic, glass, wood, nylon, right? So all these are examples for insulators. Now, one more very important thing you should remember is about conductors and insulators is, for the conductors, say suppose if we give some charges to these conductors, what happens inside these conductors? It will readily distribute all the charges on the surface of the body, right? Because there are many number of electrons which can carry those charges, right? But whereas in case of insulators, if we pass on the electric charges or electric charges to these insulators, what happens? It will readily just settle down on the surface. It will not move across the or distributed over the surface of the insulators, right? Now I think it is clear that why a plastic comb, when you rub it over your dry hair, gets electrified. It's very simple, because plastic comb is made up of an insulator. It is an insulated material, right? What happens when we rub it over dry hair? The charges from the dry hair, it will get settled down on the surface of plastic comb, because of which we can observe the static electricity for an instant of time, right? But whereas if you rub a metallic spoon over your dry hair, since the steel spoon is made up of metal, it is a conducting material, the charges which will move from the dry hair, it will not settle on the conductor. We will not able to observe the static electricity, because the charges will just get distributed over the surface of the metallic body, or it will just get conducted through our body to the earth, right? Because body is also a conducting material, because of which we are not able to observe the static electricity in case of a spoon. I hope you have understood. Now, whenever we bring a charged body in contact with the earth, what happens? The charges which are present on the charged body will pass through the conducting body and it will reach to the earth, right? So this process of sharing the charges with the earth is called as earthing or grounding. Now, where does this process do we use? We usually use this process in safeguarding the appliances or the electrical circuit which we use in our households or in offices. The electric wiring in our houses is usually made up of three different wires. One is live wire, neutral wire, earth wire. Right? These two wires, that is neutral wire and live wire, are connected to the main supply so that the electricity can be passed from power station to your house. Right? And this earth wire, what is the purpose of this earth wire? This earth wire is connected by a conducting wire to a metal plate which is buried inside the earth. Means this is usually used to the process of earthing. Why it is so? It is because whenever, say, suppose there is a fault occurred in the circuit, right? Then what happens, say, if a metallic body or a human touches this live wire, what happens? The excess of charge through this earth wire will get buried inside the earth, because of which we can avoid any damage to any electrical appliances or any damage to the human body. So this is the safety purpose use of this earthing or grounding. So we will be using this term many times in future in this chapter. So I hope you should remember that earthing means nothing but the process of sharing the excess of charges of the charged body with the earth. Now let us try to understand different methods of charging. What do I mean by methods of charging? It means methods of electrification, or how, in simple words, how a body can add up the charges, or how a body can deficit the charges, right? Basically, there are three different methods to charge a body or to electrify a body. Those are charging by friction, charging by conduction, and charging by induction. Let us try to know one by one in deep. The very first method is charging by friction. It's a very simple method to charge a body. How does it work? When two different objects or two different materials are rubbed together, right, those two materials will get charged or electrified. So that is called as charging by friction. So let us consider an example. Here I have considered an example of considering a glass rod and a silk cloth. Both are neutral bodies. Fine. They are not yet charged. When these two bodies are rubbed together, just like this, right? When they are rubbed together, both the bodies will get electrically charged. It means the glass rod is sharing its charges with that of silk cloth. What happening during this process? The glass rod, the free electrons on the glass rod are getting distributed over the silk cloth. it is losing the electrons. The glass rod is actually losing the electrons, because of which the glass rod is becoming positively charged. Whereas the silk cloth, since it is gaining the electrons from this glass rod, this silk cloth is now having excess of electrons, which means excess of negatively charged particles. So we can say this silk cloth is now negatively charged. So in this process, both the bodies, before they were neutral, but now after rubbing, what happened? Both the glass rod and as well the silk cloth has become charged. One has become positively charged and the other one has become negatively charged. So in this process, what happens? The body, when it is rubbed over another body, if the body loses electrons, it becomes positively charged, and if the body gains the electrons, then it becomes negatively charged. In the whole process, both the bodies will get charged, right? So such kind of process we call it as charging. But the second method of charging or electrification is charging by conduction. In simple terms, you can say charging by physical contact, right? For this, I'll just take an example of a pith ball and a glass rod, okay? I'll just show you an example. See, consider this is a neutral body, fine? When it came in contact with the charged body, that is the glass rod, which is positively charged, these positively charged glass rod shared its positive charge with that of this neutral body, that is the pith ball, right? What happened during the process? The free electrons which were available on this neutral body, as soon as it came in contact with this charged, positively charged body, those free electrons got distributed over the surface of this glass rod, because of which this glass rod became less positive and that positive charge was shifted with this pith ball, right? Now both the bodies have shared the charges and both the bodies have become positively charged, right? One thing what you should notice is, in the previous method, in charging by friction, what we observed, while charging, the two bodies gained two different types of charges. One was negative charge and another was positive charge. But in this method, what happens? The same charge, the charged body, whatever is carrying the charge, whether it is positive charge or negative charge, when it comes in contact with the neutral body, it will share the same charge with that body, right? This is the difference between charging by friction and as well as charging by conduction. The third method is charging by induction. In simple words, this process we call it as charging without any physical contact, right? What happens in this process? Let us consider two different bodies, right? One is negatively charged body, that is A, and one more is neutral body, which is having both the charges, positive and negative. When this negative charged body is brought closer to this neutral body, what we observed, the charges inside the body B got polarized. Polarized means those got arranged. The positive charges came at this surface and the negative charges were accumulated at this surface. Why it happened so? Because these negative charges will have repulsive force towards these negative charges, so it will go away from this surface. Whereas this positive charges will have affinity towards this negative charge because the force of attraction, right? Therefore, it will get accumulated towards this surface. So this process of alignment of charges and this process of getting polarized of the charges due to the negatively charged body bringing closer to this uncharged body is called as induction, right? This process is called as induction. Now let us take an example. I will consider a metallic sphere which is held by an insulated metal insulated stand, fine. And now what I do, this is a neutral metallic sphere. I have brought close a negatively charged rod near to this metallic sphere. Due to induction, what happens? The charges will get polarized inside this metallic sphere. The positive charges will align at one surface and the negative charges, due to the force of repulsion, it will get aligned in the another surface, right? Now suppose if I get back this negatively charged rod and remove it from here, what happens to this metallic sphere? Obviously, all the charges will come back to its position, right? Because there is no electric, there is no charge which can polarize these charges. Now, let us assume I have again brought this negative charge body to this neutral metallic sphere. Obviously, due to induction, the charges will get polarized. In this case, now what I am doing, I am connecting this metallic sphere to the earth, which means I am earthing this metallic sphere. So, what happens? These negative charges which were accumulated here, that will flow through this conducting wire to the earth, right? And only the remaining charges which are present in this metallic sphere or the positive charges which are accumulated at this surface due to this negatively charged metallic rod, right? Now suppose if I remove this negatively charged rod from this space, what we can observe, we can see that the metallic sphere now is just having the positive charges, which means now the sphere has become positively charged, right? So this is how we can charge a neutral body by bringing a electrically charged body near to it, right? By the process of induction, the charges will get polarized, and earthing the other surface of that metallic sphere, we can make this metallic sphere or body as charged body, right? This is how we can charge a body by the method of induction. Let us consider in this example two metal spheres which are neutral and they are held with insulated metal insulated strands. Now these two metal spheres are in contact with each other. Now when I bring a charged body close to this metal sphere A, what happens? Since this is a positively charged metallic rod, this will make the polarization of these charges present inside this body A. It will align all the negative charges at this surface and the positive charges towards this surface. Why? Because the positive-positive will have repulsive force, because of which it will go away from this surface, right? And the negative charge, since it will have affinity towards it because of electrostatic force of attraction, it will get accumulated at this surface. Now, since this metallic sphere is in contact with metal B, right, metallic sphere B, now these charges will also get polarized, right? Since the negative charges will have polarity towards positive, all the negative charges will come towards this surface and the positive charges will come at this surface. Now, what has happened? All the negative charges inside this body A are at one surface, and all the positive charges are at another surface of this metallic sphere B. Now, in the next step, what I will do, I will slightly make these two metallic spheres which were in contact, I will make it away, right? Then what happens? Obviously, this metallic sphere will distribute all the positive charge over its surface, and this metallic sphere, see, if I remove this metallic rod as well, all the negative charges will get distributed over this metallic sphere and all the positive charges will get distributed over the surface of this metal sphere. In short, it means both these metallic spheres, when they are kept away now, this has become negatively charged and this has become positively charged because of the induction method, right? So, in four simple steps, you can remember the process of charging by induction. What are those steps? The very first step is considering a neutral body and bringing a charged body close to it without making any physical contact, right? When it is made to come near the neutral body, what happens? Due to polarization, the charges will get aligned, right? In the second step, after the alignment of the charges, if one end of the surface is being earthed, what happens? All these charges will flow to the earth, right? And the only remaining charges on the surface of the body is this part of the charges. In the third step, if we remove this metallic, the charged metallic rod away from this sphere, the remaining charges which are at one surface will get distributed over the whole neutral body, and now this neutral body has become negatively charged. In this whole process, you can observe the inducing charges. Inducing charges means the charged body which we are using to start the process of the induction, right? These inducing charges will induce the charges in the body which are of opposite type. Say suppose if you have considered a positively charged body to the neutral body, then the neutral body will become negatively charged. Or for example, if you consider a negatively charged body and bring it close to a neutral body, then the result will be vice versa, which means the neutral body will become positively charged. And also different important points regarding this you should remember is, during this whole process, neither the neutral body will gain electrons and nor it will lose the electrons, which means it is neither gaining the electric charges and nor losing charges. What happening instead? It is just the distribution of charges taking place in the whole process, right? And the nature of induced charges always opposite to that of inducing charge. As I said earlier, the inducing charge will be different and already induced charges will be different. If this is positive, this will be negative. If this is negative, this will become positive. And the third important point you should remember is, induced charge can be lesser or equal to inducing charge, but it is never greater than the inducing charge, which means the inducing charges, these charges will be always greater than these charges which are being induced in the body. Fine. And induction takes place only in bodies, extended objects like conducting or non-conducting objects, not in the particles. Fine. These are the important points which you should remember regarding process of induction. I hope you understood all the three different methods of charging. Just like let us have a look at it. One is charging by friction. Very simple. When two different materials are rubbed together, then that process we call it as charging by friction. In this process, both the bodies will get charged and both the bodies will be having different types of charges. One will become positively charged, another becomes negatively charged. The second method is charging by conduction. Here, the charged body will come in contact with the neutral body, and then the neutral body will share the same charge as that of the charged body, right? So here the important point you should remember is the physical contact between the charged body and the neutral body. So the third process is just by which a charged body makes a conductor electrically charged without any physical contact. Without any physical contact, what we are doing, we are inducing charge on the neutral body. So this process is called as charging by induction. I hope you are clear with all these three different methods of electricity. Hope you understood this class. See you in the next class. Till then, take care.